All right, it has been a couple of days since I last worked on this project. I'm kind of hitting a point where I need to really get myself to proceed because, well, we're now getting to the stage where I just need to confine a couple of apps that are required to basically run GNOME, but not really. So the next step would be, the last step I confined the GNOME system monitor, which is pretty easy to do. And the next little thing I will do is do the GNOME Baobab, so to speak, which is basically a not a file manager, a disk usage analyzer. So that's what I will be focusing on today. So let's see what else we still need to do. We need to do the Nautilus suite, so Nautilus and Nautilus Autorun, and there's a couple more. Then we need to do the Datadub preferences and Datadub itself, which is rather, no, it's not hard, but it's something we need to, it's something special because it needs to be able to back up the whole user home directory, so it needs full access. And then what else do we have? Oh yeah, we have of course file roller, and we have more. We have transmission GTK, Nautilus CS, whatever that is, I'm not sure, and Eye of GNOME. That's basically what we need to win. Well, there's also a couple of things that are related to that. So for example, we probably also need to take care of thumbnailing. Not sure how we're going to deal with that, but fortunately today is still a reasonable easy day by doing the file system analyzer. So let's just start with that. So it's pretty easy. We are going to first just take care of the transition as usual. So let's see what we have. We have the type attribute, and after that nothing. So we're taking this stuff here. Let's have a look. Yeah. It's a little bit messy because terminal also executes shell and stuff like that, so it's a little bit different, but nonetheless, let's just set up the domain transition so that it'll run in the right domain, and then we can just start and go ahead and see what we need to confine this stuff. So paste that in. So this program is run by shell, by GNOME shell. Basically any program that you start from by clicking the icon is started by GNOME shell. Basically a couple different ways to run things in GNOME. Either it's gsession, GNOME session, which is basically the applet. GNOME shell is when you run stuff from the shell, so by clicking the icons. And then you have these settings, which or actually various components that run Pulse Audio. And there might be other ways. For example, if you would basically run a script or a program by double clicking a file in Nautilus, then it would be Nautilus actually running the file on behalf of you. That's why we just prefix all these domains, so that we can still tell whatever runs the app that it's not the app, it's not basically the app running the app, but it's the app running the app on the behalf of the user. Alright, so I think we got them all. It's time to build. I think I have them here. And then kind of need to get back into the rhythm, into the routine. So don't mind the noise in the background. It's a very nice day today here, quite with the weather, and the people outside are cutting the grass and working hard, doing what they have to do. So I did my thing. I installed it, so we can basically start and test it, but first let's just see that we're clear. Very clear. Anything else we need to do? Yeah, let's just do the set and force just to get a global view of what would be needed. And we might also want to do SE module DB just from the get go. That should give us a good overview. And then we can basically start by adding the stuff that is obvious. Like, for example, managing the dconf file in run user or in config. Alright, let's log in. So we're logged in, so let's have a look at that actual that program and make sure that we don't click anything else. So where is that file system usage analyzer, disk usage analyzer? This is Baobab, if I'm correct. So let's click that. And here you have the main file system, and here you have home. And we want it to basically not mess with anything that it shouldn't mess with. So let's have a look at outer to allow. And less it. Probably less it. Let's just less that. Damn. It's still early. Rather early. It's not as early as last week where I was really early. So here we have the stuff applicable to Baobab. So I'll just copy this over and then work from within the file itself. Gterm Baobab. So we'll just comment out some stuff, or comment some stuff, and then we'll paste that in there so that I know that this is just paste it. And then just walk through it. Let's just first remove some stuff that we can ignore, which is very little. To nothing. Now, if you look here, we always first need to take care of the things that we need to take care of, which is execute first. So we are looking for execute, and we find that here is an execute actually for disk usage analyzer to actually execute the Nautilus CS, whatever that means, executable file. Now, it's probably most likely definitely not actually executing it. But we could basically double check that by just doing a ps out. Grep 10.12. Let's see if there's anything running not in the right domain. Oh, we have two VD agents. Actually, maybe three. Yeah, three. So we should kill those. Well, we'll do that sooner rather than later. Maybe four. Anyways, it seems all is running fine. It started a couple new processes. Like, for example, the VFSD for UDisk monitor. So there's obviously some chatting going on between the disk usage analyzer and the GVFS suite of applications. But there's nothing weird going on as far as I can see. So it's actually simply just running basically either and mapping it, probably just the checking for exec, the Nautilus CS program. And we previously dealt with that in the GNOME shell part of the policy, where we basically allow some apps to basically get attributes of the default utilities and also either check for execute or mmap, which seems to be just simply a check for execute, but I'm not quite sure. So basically we can just extend this, and although we only know that it's doing this for Nautilus CS, we can probably just put it in this list and allow it to do that on all the executable files. It's probably a better idea, or a better idea. Yep, probably a good idea. So generally, I don't like to make coarse decisions or assume stuff, but this is just get attribute and a execute. There's no execute, no trans, or there's no execute and a transition. It's simply just checking for execute or maybe an mmap, but doesn't seem to be an mmap, since there's no open of the file and no actual reading of the file. But that really doesn't say all that much, because there might be a rule that just basically allows any domain to read any application executable file, and that if that's the case, then it won't show. Anyways, let's get back. Baobab, call it that way. So I took care of the executes, which is the most important thing. This is, that's this one, Nautilus. So what else do we have? Let's have a global look in here. So we have here the rewriting of Tampa Fest, which is X server. And we have some a bunch of stuff related to this, actually this XDM home. ABC the now reader pent we can basically ignore. But we have this reading of the XDM pit file, and we have the stream connect to the X server. So basically this is stuff that is common to all these applications, basically using X server. So we can basically just add that, and I'll add use that from the gsysmon, because gsysmon also has the same properties, so might as well use it from there, because we have made this split this up nice and tidy here. So let's have a look where we have. There's a lot of stuff actually. This is the part for interacting with the graphical user environment, so to speak, with XDM and X server. So let's just paste that in and then just edit that. And edit that, yeah, right. That's what I was saying. And then just work through these AVC denials. Like I said, most of this stuff is just common to any graphical user interface, or yeah, to most graphical user interfaces. So a lot of this stuff you can just assume, although that's not encouraged. So these can be removed, plus this one. So that's already a big step forward. So here we have the fonts stuff. Now let's go ahead, because all these apps need to read fonts. So here we have the part that takes care of the font reading. So basically paste it in and deal with that as well. And edit that so that it reflects our disk usage monitor or whatever the hell it is. I don't use this app very often. It's like the equivalent of DF, I guess, for a graphical user interface. Okay, so let's remove the stuff related to fonts. Alright. We have a Dbus, actually system bus clients here, because it's stream connecting to the system bus, and it's actually writing, yeah, it's writing to the system bus SOC file and using that SOC file to connect to the system bus. And this is something that the system monitor doesn't do, but I know probably, or I have an idea probably why it's doing that, but we'll see later. What else do we have? We have the stuff related to listing data home and reading XDG. Let's just do first this one. The tempt deconf tempt, because this is common. Basically this is, where is it, this stuff here. Basically all these applications need to be able to manage deconf temporary files in user run user ID deconf. So let's just paste that in as well and get rid of that, get that over with. A lot of common stuff here, basically writing policy, or at least the policy for the most of these graphical user interfaces is rather easy, although this policy is not actually complete in the sense that there are a lot of other things to take into account normally. So let's use a temp t. This can be removed as well because that's related. And then basically we have all this stuff. We have deconfig home, and it's also used by gsys one, so we can also get that. And then let's just basically where are we? So this is basically a whole set of stuff all related. So just get that going. It's just a whole list of stuff that is all loosely related, but all needed by R. But because basically, get is, it wants to basically read a file and use a home directory, config, and then deconf, and then deconf some file there. So it needs to traverse all these directories to get there. So that's the home root D, which is basically slash home. Then the home user home directory, which is basically slash home slash user. And then deconf, this is not really related to the deconf, but it is related to what something it needs it, because it needs to search local share as well. User home directory local share, which is basically local dot local is basically gconf home t, and share below there is actually data home t, but it actually needs to read that dir here, the data home dir. So we actually need to read open, read open to the. So let's just do that as well. Not sure why it needs to do it, but so read open. And then we're getting to the config, deconf stuff. And then you have this get attribute of the root file system, which is basically slash something that most of these graphical user interfaces need to do. Not quite related to deconf, but common. So all right, so we can remove a lot of stuff here. So we can remove the config home t dir search, because we have that for deconf. The data home t dir, we can remove that, we added that. Deconf config home t, yeah, we added that. FST, we added that. The deconf home t, we added that. The home user home root t, we added that. We haven't added that the debug session and system stuff. We haven't actually added the etcd config home t stuff, but we actually added the user home dirty stuff, so we need to take care of these. Etcd config home t, did we take care of did we use that for gsysmon? As you can see, gsysmon also reads password file, but it doesn't seem to be reading etcd config files. And GNOME Shell does that, doesn't it? Actually, gterm, sorry. This is quite messy. Okay, now, don't think so, but it's the same stuff. You can basically just add this by under the deconf stuff, because it's basically in also in user home dir and then slash period config So basically you could just either extend it here or just add it below here. You could just extend this like this. So because it's kind of in a similar location, not quite, but kind of. Right, so we have this one as well, and we can also take care of the password file, which is basically also common, I guess. And we have it reading and actually opening the random random device. We can basically add that in as well. Might want to give that a get attribute as well. Alright, done. Now we have some other stuff here. We have it's basically connecting to the system and session bus. And obviously remove this one as well. So let's first have a look. User ABCs, see what we have here, and this is recent, but it's not recent anymore. Yeah, so here we have the actual factual stuff that's going on. So it's actually connecting to the system bus. And it's doing so because it wants to communicate with the hostname daemon, system daemon, hostname daemon. So that's why it's actually connecting to the system bus. So that's what we got here. So let's just copy this over as well, these three. So then we can take those into account as well. They're related to it connected to the system bus. So I'll just get rid of those. And then of course it's also chatting to various session bus applications, and those can be listed with the invalid messages. They don't go to the audit log for some reason, which is basically a bug in my view. Though I'm not quite sure, it's I guess a matter of interpretation. Let's just take 400. Oops, not 5,400. It's still a little bit lot. So here we have what's going on, and we basically just need to take these and then build on those. Basically our application chatting with the other apps. And as you can see here, it's also acquiring servers on the session bus. So it's going to be getting a session on the session bus, service on the session bus. So let's just get that out of the way as well. So now we also have the dbus stuff, but let's have a look at some daemon that actually uses the system bus. Gterm doesn't, as far as I know. Same for GPTI, doesn't, as far as I know. So I'm just going to look up some some app that does actually connect to the system bus, and then just yeah, here it is. The DSD print connects to the system bus due to the and session bus due to it wanting to dbus chat to entity that's not visible here. And is that, am I crazy? But it probably wants to chat to Cups. I guess. Would make sense for a, but since I don't have a printer connected, that's basically probably why it doesn't show up. But probably this needs to be able to create connect to or chat to Cups, and that's why it's probably connecting to the session bus. So let's just add that all the way below. So this is basically, these are the rules that allow it to, and I'll just add a no, I don't need to add anything. You can basically rename these to Baobab. And then just go ahead and add the actual dbus rules for the communications. All right, so get rid of these, and then this one is a single one because it's yeah, single way. This is this is already completed, but I need to require type systemd. Hostname D. All right, and then we have this stuff here, and I'll just put this one below on top, just to show, just to make it, yeah, intuitive that it's connecting to the session bus and it has a service on the session bus. And then below I'm going to add the chat to the various components. So yeah, and then I'm going to do the routine again, basically of this, but okay. I'll just do it this way. So this is the way I do that. Connect, or it's chatting to dconf, to atsp, or atspy, whatever, how the hell you want to call it, atspy2, it's to be exact, to dump shell, and to the af C volume monitor, so that's something you would expect, probably. Not sure, actually. And the GVFD, GVFSD. Oops, dying. Now I'm making a mess. Gphoto. Yeah. Couple more. There we have at least a solid base for just starting up this stuff. So the Let's have a look here. This one. So then we need to make it actually do something. TVFSD itself. So yeah, that's about it. So we basically can go ahead and start to load this up. This should be a basis, although we've probably, when you test this in enforcing mode, then you'll probably see stuff that you haven't seen before. That's always with this. It doesn't matter. This at least gives us a solid base. So load that into the system. That's the coffee. So we loaded this into the system. And let's just do a set enforce one. Then see if we can get out of here. See if we can close this without. Yep, seems we can. And we are going to log out. And then we're going to clear the directories and kill the processes that were remaining. There were a lot of VD agent processes remaining. I could just do a history kill, but I assume that. Yeah, here to kill my users, my login users, and the same for the clear. But I could just type it instead of doing it the stupid way. Not sure why I even do it this way, but all right. Let's just verify that it's clear. Home, my login user, and it's clear. I'll accept the SSH. There, which we want to keep in there so that I can log in using my PKI, my public key. Alright, so LSRZ temp to get rid of pools. There's a single pools in there. So that's RM, RF, temp, and pools. So we're clean now. We're in enforcing mode. Get enforce. Get enforce. But we have the don't audits loaded, the don't audit rules. So that means that we're seeing a lot. And we added some basic rules with regard to the disk analyzer, disk usage analyzer. The basically the graphical DF, I guess. So what we're going to do now is basically run it again in enforcing mode and just see what we were missing, and then just add those. First let's see that we're clean, make sure that we're clean, because we don't want to get confused by old APC denials. That wouldn't be good. So we're at 10 o'clock, actually 10 past 10. And we have no matches, so we're clean. So we can go ahead and log in. So we're logged in. We're in a forcing mode. And just show you that now, because, well, I actually have access to a shell in a forcing mode. So I can just open up a shell and type GenForce. And it'll basically work as if it's not confined. It shows as if you're not confined, so that's nice, because the user shouldn't basically actually have to notice that it's confined unless it's doing something that it shouldn't do, obviously. Okay, so now basically try to open it, see if it actually opens. And it does open. Let's see what ABC denials we have. So we have a file descriptor getting inherited or used from the login user domain. And this is something that basically we can add a single rule later, where we can basically, where we basically need to allow this for almost any user application. But let's just add this in as is instead. Let's go up. And let's just add that here, I guess. The file descriptor. Now this is all old stuff that we can ignore. Same for this. Same for that. This as well. And that's basically all we have. So we're pretty clean right now. So let's see what happens if we use some of this functionality. So couldn't scan folder. That's because we're in a forcing mode. So what the bus is trying to do? It's writing to data home, and it's actually reading the user home there, and that's basically because it wants to actually list all user home content, and we need to allow that. So now I actually know what it does. It's basically, let's just set it for 0 and just see it. Go ahead and try that again. It's not permission denied. Is this a refresh button? It's a refresh button. So now we have basically this stuff. Let's see what that means. So that this is what it means. So it basically reads every directory, and actually also the files. But look at the files. It's reading them but not actually opening them. So how do we deal with that? How do we see, for example, how do we make sure that this works? But let's make also sure that the integrity is guaranteed to some extent. Well, to actually be able to read a file, you'll need to open it. Now there might be no, there's not. So we can basically allow this program to basically list all the directories in the user home dir. That's something that he needs to do. and to read and get attributes of the files, use home content files, but not open them, and then work on that. But there's more here. Let's just see if there's also files in there that it actually needs to open, that it actually needs to read. But it doesn't look like there is. There is. It does create some file in the data home door, which we need to take care of. But overall, it doesn't seem to be actually opening a file. So we can just add this rule here. This is the rule that we're going to add. So we are going to first extend this one here to actually read that and use a home directory. Do we have that rule? And open it as well. Yeah. And open it as well. This allows that program to actually list the user home directory so that it can get all the directories inside the /home/myloginuser. And then it wants to actually myloginuser bob t, and then we're going to use the type attribute user home type file, and we're going to say only get attribute and read, and this is needed. The get attribute is needed to actually list the user home directory. That basically requires that you both read the directory file of the user home directory. So basically /home/myloginuser, you read that directory file to get the entries of the contents in there, and then you get actually get the attributes of the contents that's in the directory file of its parent, and then basically read. Now I'm not sure what the read means in this case. It might be actually just checking for read, because it's not actually reading the files. Because if it was reading the files, it would have opened it as well, and there's no sign that it's opening the files, and it doesn't make sense for this program to open them. So it may well be that it's just checking for read. I'm not sure. But needless, it just seems to need this, but we could basically add a rule with the outed axis if we were sure. I could make a comment in here which basically says outed axis read, and then with a question mark, so that later, at a later point, when I'm trying to basically tighten this up, I could try and see if it all works fine if I just basically don't audit the read and then allow it to audit access and see if that works. And that basically would confirm that it's actually just checking for read rather than, because the problem with SE Linux is that when it's checking something, like for example check for a read, that it actually shows up as it trying to read, but it's not trying to actually read because it doesn't open the file. If you really read something, then you need to open it. But if you just check for read, then you'll get to read without the open usually, and that basically often is a sign that it's just checking, and then you can basically use a different set of rules, basically just silently deny the actual read permission and then just allow the audit access permission, and that basically allows it to check for just check basically. and not actually read it. But in practice, it doesn't really matter because it can't read it if it can't open it anyway. So in that sense, just so this should take care of that. Let's see what else we have. So now it can list all these directories below the in the user home dir. Now we have also it creating a file in data home. So let's grab data home and then grab baobab. To see what it actually is creating there. And we should basically also grab for create probably. Grab create and then less that, but it's not much, probably a few, maybe one. So it's creating this recently used XBL file, and this is something that we this is basically some file that basically shows up the recently used files. So this is not really a thing that is baobab only. So we need to make that basically a we have a oh yeah, that's tracker data. Let's just do it different. Show up a little less. Yeah, so now we have a bit better view. So yeah, it's actually just this is just doing creating that recently used XBL file in local share. So this basically shows us exactly what's going on. So we can't actually add a named file transition here because it's basically having a random suffix and it's going to rename. So let's just auto to allow this so that we have all the permissions that it really needs, and then just implement this with a type transition. But first let's have a look. So save this and let's have a look at the file context file to make sure that we don't have a recently used in local share yet. This is actually the first one. Now I will just call this I will do some let's have a look. We have a GTK home here. This has similar properties, but we're not going to use that type, although we could. Okay, so where are we going to add this rule? I guess we can just add it to baobab, but we're not giving it a baobab specific name, but we need to add it somewhere, so might as well just add it there because it's the first one that's using it, so that's fine. So I'll just add type recently used stupid name data home key. And this is basically recently used data home t, and this is a file type. Now let me explain something, and this only needs one more user home type. So we can't use a named file transition here. But if you basically be conservative with transitions and use a named file transition wherever possible, then it doesn't matter often. Baobab doesn't create any files in data home tether, so it will not conflict. But if at some point it would create a file in data home t and that file would also be a file with a random suffix, then you would have a problem, because then you can't basically tell to SLinux create that file with this type and that other file with another type, because there's no way to tell the difference. But if you basically use the named file transitions wherever possible, and then use normal file transitions where you can't use named file transitions, then with a little luck you'll be able to do that without conflicts. So let's, and I'll just add it right below here, these rules, and just edit them. So basically what you get is this recently used data home t, and it's adding that in local share, which is basically generic data home. We could basically add this, but we'll just add it there, and then just create a type transition here, type transition, and then use this type here, or let's just add them both. But it's for a file, actually. It's the recently used file. And then just add this type. And unfortunately, we can't use a named file transition because the name is random. So that's taking care of that. But we also need to basically make sure that we have a file context for this stuff. So, FC. And then local share, so I'll just copy this one over, or actually let's just take this one here and call that recently used data home t, recently used data home t, and then let's have a look at what it's actually like and what we can use. So let's actually also, where's recently used? So basically this one here, local share. And then just use that with do some. So I'll copy this here. And then just remove this because this is random. And then just add a star that every file there, every file actually, yeah, good point, created there will be labeled, or should be labeled with this type. So this should take care of the file context as well. And then let's go back. Actually, it didn't save. Ouch. Looks like I forgot to save. Gee. Type recently used data home t. Type attribute recently used data home t file type, use home type, G. And then just copy this over and do it all over again. I didn't save it for some reason. That's also because I'm just not comfortable right now. recently used data home T. And then type transition. Again. And then just make sure you save it properly. Would be nice. Yes, save that. Sticky keys. All right. Seems to be there. So let's go back. Let's have a look at something that we might be overlooking here. This is the stuff that we took taken care of. Yeah, we have pulse audio temp T. Reading. So it's reading a pulse audio temp T. Not sure why. So I'll just leave that in there for a while. Let's see if we have some unrelated stuff. Always keep an eye on that. But seems not. No. So it seems we're set. So basically what we can do now is add that. Well, we can also, well actually we're not going to do that right now, but eventually we can also add a rule to disallow it to list anything else, but that's for later. Let's just build this one up. And we have a typo, of course. So where is user home type? Well, I know where it is. Here it is. Home type. Let's go back. Try that again. We have another typo. Syntax error. Just below gconf home t. Oh, just on top gconf home t, and where is the gconf? Here we have it. Stupid typos. And then we have a known type recently used data home t, and I would have sworn recently used. Ah, exactly the same typo that I made with searching it. I'm just not very comfortable right now, sitting comfortable, so I'm making these typos that if you would work on a normal desk properly, you wouldn't make those, because you would have a good view of your keyboard. But now I'm just basically laying back, sitting back. And that's causing all kinds of stupid typos. Which is unfortunate, but hey, you gotta do it with what you have. You have to do it with what you have. So I'll just restore the contexts of that file in data home. restore for now, restore con RV. Let's just use RV so that I can figure out any other stuff that might be created. Home with a wrong type login user, and then local share. See what else is. Oh, I guess that file is already removed. No, it's not. And show me a LSLZ. No. So, why is that? Why isn't it catching it? It might just be due to the period here. So let's just try see if that's it. Ah, right, this is an invalid type there as well. But also just escape the period just to be sure. It's not related, but making it clean, it's better to just escape it than and then just after I loaded it, try it again. So that was a stupid typo as well, because it didn't restore the context. Should be doing it now, and it does. All right, so that's fixed as well. Let's see what error clean. Let's just say recent. We're clean. So let's just go back to our thing. And let's just so we're, and it has all kinds of stats, I guess. Let's just quit this. We're still in enforcing. Oh, we're actually in permissive mode. So let's go into enforce mode, but you won't be able to do that here. Set enforce one, of course. That's obvious. So let's do that here. Set enforce. One. And let's just use the recent audit to allow. This is we can ignore that, but with this one should be allowed. The unlink. So that one should be added. Not here, but I'll just this goes a little bit quicker. So it also needs to unlink this file. Let's just add that in. Basically delete the file. So that's basically how that works. Probably, I'm not sure why, but whatever. Okay, so let's just run this again in a forcing mode. Let's see where this gets us. So we have this one here, and then could not scan. So it's not working properly yet. Let's see what we have. And don't tell me it's open. That's weird. I thought we added this. Basically what it's saying is can't read the user home types, but we added that as far as I can remember. So I must have been doing stupid things again. Oh right, not stupid things again. But just not complete. Actually, this can be moved here. User home type. So basically, it needs to list all these user home content directories as well. So not just the home directory, but every directory below there as well. And that should take care of that. And that's not a problem as long as it just can't read the files. And if I'm correct, that should be the case. It shouldn't be able to read them. But we can check that. We're going to just check that because it's actually just important that we have integrity. So I'm going to just check that out. In this case, I'm going to, what I told you about that audit access, I'm just going to do that right now because this application would be able to read, or not, you wouldn't be able to read every file in the user home directory because it can't open the file, but still, since it needs some level of access to each file in there, we need to make sure that it's as tight as possible because, well, we have some valuable files in there. We have our GNOME keyring files, we have our SSH files, and we're going to have our GPG files in there. So we need to make sure that that's basically taken care of properly. So 1044. This is actually why we are confining it. So we need to make sure that we will actually do our job right. We're not confining it for our health. These are actually the things that you want to make sure that it can do its job, but not more. So here we have it. So now it can do its job. Let's have a look. Oh yeah, link files. So it should also be able to get attributes of link files, I guess. And maybe even open them, read them as well. So let's just make that get attribute and read as well. So let's just add that as well. Then it's in the same run, also take care of so this is different. Let's just make sure that we're not getting ahead of ourselves. So let's just do this here. And audit access, use audit access here. So this is going to be three rules. Actually, oh. We're going to allow the get attribute. We're going to don't audit the read. And we're going to allow it to audit access. Let's see where this gets us. Okay, so let's see what we have. 47. We're going to log out and start clean. Yeah, so log out, close this one up. Log off. Clean up our mess. Kill the processes. Should be here somewhere. And then clear directories. And then do the pulse audio dance. Yep. All right. Now see. Let's see if we're rather clear at 48. Not quite, but good enough. And let's just log in again. If we are in enforcing, get enforce. Of course, we are enforcing. And then just act as if everything is normal. I'm just an unsuspecting user that wants to see the state of my user home directory. Do I have space, and how? Where is the disk occupied and where not? So here it is. We're just running it. We're running it. There's no errors. So it seems from that perspective that the audit access is actually working. This. And these are currently shown, but that's because we don't audit them to them, and we're still running with SE module DB with the don't audit removed. So once they are inserted, we can just ignore them, but the link file needs to be read, so we actually need to add a read to the link file. But other than that, looks good. So add the read for the link file. Oops, where are we? get attribute and read. So this is actually what a user should be able to do. And everything else, you just shouldn't be able to do it. At least I think. Let's just have a look at some of these options. There seem to be some options in there. Not many though. Scan folder, scan remote folder. Now I'm not going to do... I'm just going to see what this brings me. And it wants to... create some content in config home t. So I just need to figure out what that is. Set enforce 0, and then just try and reproduce that. Cancel, scan folder, and then it opened it again. And let's see if we can now figure that out. Yeah. So let's see what this is all about. Grab create. So it's actually creating a dir in the config. In the config home there, and then inside there it seems to be creating that bookmarks file. So let's have a look. And then config, and then here this GTK 3.0 is created with a generic type because we were in permissive mode. So GTK 3.0, and inside there we have the bookmarks there. So we need to basically take care of this. So we are going to create a GTK config home t type. And this seems to be a difference between GTK 2 and 3. Because I think that GTK 2 actually creates the GTK bookmarks in the home root, user home directory. And GTK 3 does it neatly in the config home. So I think what we need to do. I'll just do it the way I think. It's basically excessive use of types, what I'm doing now. Because I could probably just use the GTK home T type for this as well, because it's the same. The difference is that GTK 3 creates it in a different content, in a different style. It actually creates the dir and then the file in there, which is neat and tidy. Whereas GTK 2 just basically creates that GTK bookmarks file, single file in the user home directory. Actually, let's just be let's just be efficient and just use that TTK home file for that, because I'm pretty sure that I figured I know what's going on here. So let's just go back and grab config empty. Actually, just grab config empty. And grab baobab. And then add it to allow. Yeah, this gives us. Some stuff, but not enough. But I know what's going on here. So basically what you have here is this is actually config where it's adding the name and writing, but it's not creating a config there, so we're going to remove that here. But we need to allow it to get attributes and search, but it's already allowed probably somewhere below. Yeah, it's the get attribute and search is already allowed. So that we can basically remove that. And then it's actually creating a dir. But this, it needs to basically get attributes and search. Maybe even read and open, but and this is actually GTK home tdir, which we're going to take care of soon. And then the same for GTK home t, and it actually also writes and adds name to the GTK home dir, because it's actually creating that file, that bookmarks file in the GTK dash 3.0 dir. So what we're getting here is a type transition, and we use, in this case, we're going to use a name file transition, because the GTK, this basically this policy is for this version of Fedora, and this version of Fedora, and basically also the new GNOME 3.8, they all use GTK 3.0, so we can just basically use a name for the transition, and then basically it's creating a dir GTK home t with this type GTK home t, and then basically the name is GTK 3.0, I think it was 3.0, not 2.0, because 2.0 actually does a different thing. So it's, is it GTK 3.0? Yep, it is GTK dash 3.0. So that takes care of that. The type is already in there. Might want to allow this to get attribute as well. So this seems to be right. Yeah, so I'm going to save and exit this, and then in the file context file I'm going to take care of the file context for config GTK 3.0. So I'm just going to grab something KUU and then just GTK 3 and then escape the period, because this is a dir 3.0. And then just give that a type of GTK home t. So again, GTK 2 creates it here, basically just straight into the home dir and just a single file for the GTK bookmarks. Whereas GTK 3.0 for that same stuff uses the GTK dash 3.0 dir in the config dir to create its bookmarks there in there. So that's why I'm using the same type here, because I could basically call this GTK2 home tea and this GTK3 config home tea, but that would be excessive use of types. So I'll just make it like this, and that should be suffice. So let's build. Install, and I'm not going to log out right now. I'm just going to run a restore on config so that the files are labeled properly, and then I'm just going to go ahead and try some more stuff. So let's restore con. Been a while since I ran it, and instead of local share I'm going to use config, and now it's actually restoring the context of the GTK dir and that bookmarks file in there, and now it's properly labeled from that perspective. So first of all, I'm just going to try and out a little bit more. So let's say I want to list the, I guess, documents. They're all empty documents. So documents 4K, that's the directory, probably the size of the directory, and it's empty. And then I can basically switch to the diagram, and that's all gravy. So let's just see if we have new ABC denials for 11.2. And now we're getting some stuff here. So we can ignore the reads, but we can ignore the opens. So why is it opening? Grab bop, and then less it. See what's happening here. So it's actually reading the ice out home file because it's actually opening it, and then it's actually reading the bash profile, and it's actually reading the pulse cuckoo. So that's just actually some stuff that we need to take care of. So out of to allow, let's have a look at that. So we need to take care of these, and we, for now, we really just going to ignore this last one, because we are eventually going to create private types for for the bash config files, because as you can see currently, so it wants to actually read some bash config file, but we don't want it to actually be able to read generic user home content. So we really, that's a good reason to actually just create a private type for bash, and maybe we'll do start that today, maybe not, maybe because it's related. So it's probably do that so this is all related here. So let's paste these two in. I'll just allow it to get attributes as well. And the same for this one, get attributes. This is the pulse cookie in the user home directory. So this is allowed. Now we need to, well, if we're doing this, then Yeah, because we're getting now a little bit, how would I say this in a good way? We're getting we're straying a little bit from our path if we're going to now all of a sudden also confine the bash config files. But from the other perspective, it's just a good idea to do that, because yeah, it might actually need that. Well, it doesn't actually need it, but we want to make sure that this ends clean. So it's probably just a good idea to just take care of it right now and get it over with, since I'm doing it now anyways. So let's just go all the way on top and just create it here. So type bash home t, and this is a file type. But this will probably open up a can of worms. User home type. And then basically we need to require our user to, or allow a user to actually manage that file. Or actually manage those files. So let's just take this rule here. Add that here, and then just change that to bash home t, and then add a truckload of type transitions, named type transitions. So that's actually fortunate. Problem is, there is a problem here, probably, but we'll see. We'll see. Actually, that's the question, whether we will see bashmt, and it's only a file, but we have various bash files in there. We have four of them to be exact, so I'll just copy them over so that I have a look at it. So we have bash history, which might actually user. So as soon as I figure out that any of these files get created with a random suffix, we're screwed here, because we can't actually and I'm afraid that that's going to be the case actually, because we really need to make sure that users create files and user home directories with a generic type by default. So let's remove these. Let's in the meanwhile have a look at etc scale. Let's etc scale. And then ls all, because it's a directory. etc scale. Skeleton. See, it doesn't create that bash history. Let's the be that best history might just be a problematic one, but we'll see. So this should take care of all this, except that we need to also take care of file context. So we got, and I'll just paste this in here again. Paste. Home. Dear. And then we have bash history. Then we can just copy this over a couple times, but instead this is bash logout. Bash profile. I think that bash history might cause issues. Not sure. And remove those. So this is bash. Oops, this is bash. Let's make that. And we have an error. Doing wrong here. What am I doing wrong here? Yeah. This type attribute is these type of this is so high up in the policy that the type attributes aren't available yet. File type, user home type. So those are things that you need to be aware of. Now this is going to change, well, currently not that much actually. Student. That music audio home key, that sucks. And we have a cache, we have a session log. Oh yeah, that's fine. That's fine. All looks good. Yep, all looks good. Alrighty. So let's just log out and start all over again. We know it needs to be able to write or read some bash config stuff. So, kill processes. Clear user home directory. And then remove pulse audio temp file. And then out search M11 ABC TS 11 17 audit to allow less. Are we clear? We're clear. Log in and go all over this stuff again. But now we'll probably see a lot of other stuff. With regards to bash, fortunately not. So let's open up a shell, because now we're basically we're dealing with bash again also, so we need to also basically make sure that that stuff works before we go ahead. So id, so now it's actually see. But still fine. It seems to be still fine. You see, I was worried that it bash would somehow create the bash history file with a random suffix and then basically move it from the random suffix bash history to the normal bash history, and that would basically give us a lot of problems, because then we wouldn't be able to use a named file transition. But so far seems that it's not doing it, although I might be wrong. So let's open up the disk usage analyzer, and this is all still working. Let's go back, scan folder. And let's just scan something, and then not this one actually. So this scanning, nothing in there though. Let's have a look again. And here is that open. So we can ignore all these reads, because those are basically unrelated, but this bash MT read opens. So far it seems, oh yeah, and check minor effects now all of a sudden wants to get attribute bash. So let's just grab bash empty. Let's see what's going on. Profile. So they're basically want to read the profile. But seems that TrackMinerFS just wants to get attributes, and let's see if there's other similar things where TrMinerFS. I think there are similar ones where it just wants to get attributes of some files. Yeah, miner is mining. So let's for now just do this. Let's see where that gets us. And then just basically allow our Baobab to read bash empty files. Where are the others that it needs to read? There were some other files that it needs to read, plus audio, yeah. So I'll just add bash empty to the in the mix. There. Alright. And then hopefully there won't be any issues. I see that, oh yeah, DTK. That's also all fine now. Yeah, DTK bookmarks, fine. Then it's just basically adding these bookmarks. So that's basically why these bookmarks are done, I guess. So yeah, it still all looks fine. So far, so good. Alright, so let's just try something that shouldn't be able to do. And it's enforcing, isn't it? No, it's not. Gee. Damn. Damn, damn, damn. Okay, let's go all the way back. I wasn't enforcing, and that's then it's not showing everything all the time. I need to be enforcing. To make sure that I see everything, and that if something doesn't work, that I also know. Let's open a shell. Okay, let's have a look. This is all fine. Okay, looks good. Let's just wait a second. Make sure our stuff is clear. A bit clear though. So now, also let's check out. Actually, open up this bigger. And now, of course, I'm getting new AVC denials. But our bash files are still labeled properly. So that's okay. Less page history. History. Yeah, seems to be doing it right. See if I got AOC now, or I'll do an LS all again. Still all seems fine. Just want to make sure that I'm taking care of the bash history properly. So this should be allowed eventually. You want to basically give the user some discretion over its own files, eh? Because if for some reason pulls audio messes up and has some corrupt config file, then I guess, well, in a kiosk mode, and a user wouldn't know what to do anyway, so the administrator would probably have to kick in and remove the corrupt config file or something like that. So still something that I need to basically consider later. So we're at 3.1. We're clean, so let's open up the file system analyzer. So there's a lot of stuff in evolution. Let's have a look what it says. Yeah, these can all be ignored. These are foul reads. And this can be ignored. So far, so good. Except, now this is also fine. So this looks good. Now let's try and do the same, but then for the remote folder, I'm a little bit worried about this. But it probably won't even work. See, it's not allowed to execute generic binaries, and it's actually a matter of generic binaries. So let's see if we have it. Yeah, oh, here we have this one. So it's not allowed to execute Nautilus Connect server, is it? So that's cool, fine, that's fine. Currently we don't want to support it, but at some point we want to basically support that. But not now. So that functionality doesn't work, that remote service functionality, not unless we take care of. Well, this one here, vert. This, we don't want to allow this. Why is it taking so long? Why can't I just say, okay, I'm not doing this? So this sucks. So user, sucks. We need to just don't audit as much as possible actually everything. So it's basically really simple from now on. Just don't audit reads and get attributes of any file type, dir and file and link file. That's basically it. We don't want this user to be able to see what is taking up what space in a system-wide level. So we're going to create a very coarse rule all the way below where we allow it to actually do its thing in the user home directory. Where is it? What do we allow that? Below. Yeah, here it is. So I'll remove this comment and list, leave that in, and then basically make a new comment. Don't, or basically only home dirs, only home dir, and then just basically add a don't audit that basically catches everything else. file type, and then basically for dir link file and file. Let's just see if that build. It's a little bit, you really need to make sure that you're taking care of everything else before you do this, because else you're going to be silently denying some legit stuff. And then basically get attribute and read. So that should take care of that stuff. Although unfortunately it takes a while for it to basically realize that it's not allowed access, but I guess that's something you can't really prevent. So I guess we're almost there. So basically what we're going to do now is we're going to SE module B to remove any silent denial, or to we just hide anything that we shouldn't see. Then we're going to log out and remove the dir again, and then just log in again and just see if we're staying clean. So yeah, there's some functionalities not working yet with regard to scanning remote systems, remote file systems, because you'd need to run the Connect server, the Nautilus Connect server, which we currently have not confined. So we need to really, if we want to basically support that at some point, we really need to confine the Connect server, the Nautilus Connect server, before we actually allow our Baobab to actually run that with a domain transition, obviously, or probably. Okay, let's see what we have in added messages. We at 3.9 right now. Well, we're not clear yet. We have some stuff here all of a sudden. We have some signals, and we have abort applet writing to abort config home t. So we need to allow that. Abort applet. abrt apple, and that's abrt config home t, and that's a write. So if it's writing, then it's also adding a name. It's actually creating something in there. That's obvious. So I'll just add the name so that I can see next time it tries what it's actually trying to do. And then we have a gsession self signal and a gnome shell self signal. Basically all these, I'm not going to use all these though, but yeah, eventually all these programs need to be able to send a signal to self. That's just truth. But I'm just going to do now gsession, wasn't it? Yeah, gsession and gshell. So gsession, do we have any cells for gsession? We do, so I'll just add that here. Should clean this up. Course. And then the same for this shell. Do we have self rules? Yep, process, and I'll just add a signal. But yeah, each of these processes really need to basically be able to I guess all three of these, although signal I wouldn't, but certainly set chat, get chat, I guess, get scheduler info and signal. But I'm not going to get ahead of myself, so I'm just going to do it like this. But from experience, I can tell you that they all need that or want that at some point. So we logged off. And I'll just see if we're clean now. At 4.3. Let's say call it 4.2. We're clean. All right, so let's just act like nothing happened. And now all of a sudden, the stuff got solid. So you see, that's weird, but okay. But dbus wants to execute a file. Oh yeah, that's strange. That now all of a sudden, start to bark. But it does make sense. So let's see if we can get this to so this is the session. Now let's just go one by one. Cache home tdir search. I'll just tell you the point. So let's just clean this up. So let's just get attributes and search. Get attribute. Fonts. Yeah, it's actually just so we need to take care of fonts, and then we have gshell data home d, and this can be done. And then we need to take care of fonts, and we can use the fonts from Baobab, because that has a pretty decent, and then just basically G session. And then use the font stuff here, and I'll just remove this here, and then just change this to reflect the session. That's strange, that all of a sudden it starts to bark. It was working fine until now. I wonder why that is. So that takes care of fonts. And then we have the online account reading tempters. I'll just leave that the way it is for now. But it's reading fonts, yeah, it makes sense, because when that's basically why it did show those blocks in the error message rather than a normal font. So that's basically the session. But now at least it shows your actual fonts, but still something's wrong. Allowed, file system get attribute. Got all. Is that all you are crying about? No, I don't believe that that's all. But it's a start. Maybe it has to do with the GNOME Online accounts daemon, but I doubt it. Still crashing. This is allowed. It's all allowed except this one. I don't see how that's actually related. But let's just add it anyway. So temp T, do we have that anywhere? No, it's not actually. Doing anything in temp run. I'm not sure what. Read get attribute. Open search. Not open. Let's just add these. I don't know what it's doing. Basically add a comment. Don't know. I personally just doubt that this is related at all. But let's just try it. That's probably something silently hidden. And I don't think it's related to it not being able to execute packets git either. So it's probably going to crash again. If it's consistent, then it should. Yeah, and it is. So that wasn't even related to online accounts daemon. But there's no AVC denials currently. So something is silently denied. Because I allowed everything in there, so I just really need to as a module DB, which just totally sucks. It's just strange that maybe it's related to the bash profile or bash configuration files. But something obviously changed, and I don't know what it is. So let's see. This is allowed. And here we have some. This is just weird. Maybe it's then actually related to you know, packets git, though I doubt it. It's just nothing else. So we're at the point where, let's just, maybe it's dbus. Let's not get ahead of ourselves. So it's not dbus. so right before abort. Because abort is basically noticing that something went wrong. Went all out. So what does this actually tell me? It tells me that the last thing it's trying to do trying to get out rid of puzzle file, but I don't see it. I don't see how that's related all of a sudden. I can add it, but that makes sense. Damn. Sucks. That's the goddamn deposit file. Guess I need to try something. Oh shit. I shouldn't have run that command. Getting a little bit annoyed that now all of a sudden the stuff breaks for no apparent reason. That is not nice. Stuff needs to make sense. If it doesn't make sense, then it doesn't make dollars. Nope. So it's not that. What is it then? So here it starts to write like a mother. All I see is insignificant stuff, or at least should be insignificant stuff. Let's just add it to allow, get a better overview, last step. If that session executing shell I guess I could allow try that. Though it doesn't make sense either, but I should try something. Now I already added a, did I remove it? Other text, no I didn't. So let's just allow it. Have to try something. But those things worked before, so I don't understand why it wouldn't work now. Try it again. Patience is a virtue, don't panic. Everything has a rational explanation. But this isn't it. But this isn't it. Nope. It's not. So then here we have some stuff. Here we have some stuff. Okay, so let's just paste this stuff in here. That makes sense. This makes sense. Seems there's a lot of loose ends still in the policy. Seems there's a lot of loose ends in here. let's go back again and just allow that desession shit again. Maybe it's related in some way anyways. Just need to go through this, whether we like it or not. Not yet. I thought that I already allowed this, but it's not. A lot of loose ends. Try this again. Nope. Now it also hangs here. It's messy. A lot of loose ends, I guess. Evo alarm signal. Oh man. NPO. Really, 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 really odd. A lot of VDA agents. Jesus Christ. Okay, so something came. Modules. I supposedly have a SFTP as a module. Is my or I just SFTP. Can't find that stuff, of course. Jesus Christ. So kids, learn a lesson. If you create some modules, then make sure you actually save them properly. Christ, which module was it? Okay, let's just grab my must be somewhere in there. Can't find it anymore. I can't believe that I didn't save. Dispatch. Wow. Now I've kind of forgotten what I added last. But seems that it's that there was some corruption going on. That it basically was a combination of corruption in the dirt together with Tool's audio going all crazy. That's some I can imagine that, but it's kind of frustrating as well that you need to remind people. It would be nice if people could remind themselves when they ask a question that they also keep in mind that they first try to answer the question themselves, but that's easier said than done because yeah, you need to basically also understand what you do to be able to reason, find the reasoning behind what you're doing and stuff, and how you can basically get around that. And that's still what this issue that we're facing. I'm not quite sure what's going on. I know that somehow Pulse Audio, I think that somehow Pulse Audio got corrupted. The Pulse Audio config files in the user home there, and that the reason is that G session crapped out. Or that, yeah, that 28. Clean. And we are enforcing. Let's just try to pick this up a little bit. And so that I can. Okay, we're back. We're back. Holy moly, yeah, that's just don't audit. So things turned out to be more complicated. Okay, we are going to have to do it all over again once more. It's very tiresome currently. So I need to basically stop this stuff as soon as possible, but for some reason it doesn't want to cooperate with me. So I need to clear all the processes, remove stuff, LSRC temp, and then RMRF temp. Now hopefully I can finish this. Jesus. What it started as something really simple, just turned out to be very chaotic. Alright, so I'm logged in. Do I have AVC denials? Yeah, I'm kind of disappointed with that T-rooted stuff. In the beginning it worked, and then they decided to just undo what they did due to some changes, and that's fine. But if you undo it, then make sure that you do it right. And if it's with regard to Fedora, then that's no problem if there's bugs, because Fedora, yeah, we expect there to be bugs. But if it ends up in Red Hat Enterprise Linux, then that's just not the way it should go, of course. That's just plain amateur stuff, if you ask me. But yeah, on the other hand, this is just a minor thing related of compared to other issues, of course. Now we have ABC denials. I mean, it's probably for linked files. Actually, all kinds of stuff. So added to allow that. Oh, it's already added to allow. So there's more bugs to fix. So let's just add these rules. Yeah, get all kinds of stuff now. And then just stop this, because it's just getting too long. The video is getting too long. I'm losing my concentration. Where is the rule that don't audit? Yeah, this one. So you get other stuff as well. Like, for example, SOC files, character files, block files, probably. So let's see if we can do that. FIFO file, SOC file, TR file, block file. A link file, we already have link file, and then just basically do a search for DIRS only. And then make that. And this should be it. Everything is taking longer than it started. So smooth this morning, everything went right, and then all of a sudden you get all kinds of stupid stuff. that and everything just doesn't go right, nothing goes right. It's always, you see that often. Just like now, I'm just looking for a make command and I can't find it. Always the same. Okay, with guest, it's a different and do not gen. Let's see if he has updated his blog. It's so annoying that people just think that you can just make assumptions by just, oh, it's executing, it's trying to execute something, and then all of a sudden I should know what exactly is going on. That's not the way it works. When it comes to SE Linux, you need to know all the details to make an informed decision. Not, you can't just go out and assume all kinds of stuff. It's just not the way. Okay, we're clean now. Okay, so guys, I'm going to just stop this episode. It seems to work all. Okay, so there's some more stuff here, and I need to actually see that. What is it trying to create? A, but that's fine. So it's a file there. ABRT Apple config. It's creating a file. And it's trying to get attributes of the file, the root file system. Keeps going and going and going. All of a sudden, I thought I had it taken care of a little bit, but there's more loose ends than I thought. Alright, so I'm going to quit this and I'm going to talk with this guy, because this is going to be long.